Was born in Ohio on June 12, 1870. He was the oldest son and lived in a farm. When he got older, he met Lisa Young and fell in love with her, got married, and soon after they started. Working as a blacksmith. Washington, they made a few friends, and one of them, or the main friends that they visited and kept in contact, were Dan McGowan and Margaret Wilson. Now, Margaret had a brother, and his name was Roy Wilson. And at the time, he was 22 years old. This is in the year 1910. Despite the age difference, Roy and Edward became good friends. In 1913, Edward and his family moved to Oregon, and soon after, they got a divorce. Was very profitable in the 1920s. the snow. Not everyone would continue to do this for a long term. So, in the end, it's like everything. If it is profitable, everyone wanted to do it or wants to do it. But not everyone is willing to pay the price. It's time to go blind. So Edward Nichols kind of accepted his explanations, but he said, well, if I'm gonna go, I'm gonna bring a friend with me. And Lee Collins, who was in his late 30s, and Edward Nichols used to work together at the Cascade Lakes. So he decided to ask Colin to join him and split the profits. In the fall of 1922 to the spring of 1923, Edward and Lee lived there and worked at the cabin, that is, and did everything that Logan asked. Actually sell them. if you're scared, what do you do, right? And that is when Roy Wilson comes to the picture. Remember, Roy Wilson, the brother of the lady that used to be friends with the couple when they were married. I know, so many people. But keep up, this is a small town, so not many new names are gonna be popping up here. Okay. So, let's talk about who Roy Wilson is. Yeah, we know. It's the brother of the lady who was friends with them. But he was not from the area either. He was born in Colorado in 1888. And the family then moved to Washington. He was 7. His sister, Leoella, got married to Dan, and then they met the couple that we already mentioned, Liza and Edward Nichols. And that's how they met, became friends again. However, Edward was 18 years older than Roy. Then Roy was same time, so he moved from Washington to Bend. In 1914, when he got a job as a logger in a new company that paid very well and things were going amazingly for Roy. However, in 1915, his father, Charles passed away, so he took responsibility for his mom and his grandma, not only emotionally, and you know, he kind of stayed with them, but also financially, he was going to provide for both of them. Then he enlisted in the Marines. He was never sent to World War I, but he was sent to Galveston, Texas, on October of 1917 to patrol the Gulf of Mexico oil, something very important that they had to keep an eye on for 2 years. So he didn't actually go to war, but he did serve for that. And he trained, and he was serving. In the beginning, his mom didn't want him to go. I mean, it must be hard as a mom to see this happen after you lose your husband and, you know, the war. I can only imagine how she felt. But he promised he'll be back, and he promised to continue to send them the money so they can continue to live where they were living at the time. That happened to be the same neighborhood that Edward Nichols' brother lived at. So it's like Roy and Edward, for some weird, twisted reason, for whatever purpose life had for them, they were always somehow close by. It's unbelievable. So that is how they connected after leaving Washington. They connected about, you know, they kind of kept in touch, living in the same area, kind of by close family. And that's how he knew about his career in the Marines. So he talked to Roy, and Roy was not sure. But he later on agreed and said, "Well, I am going, but I'm gonna bring a buddy with me, and his name is Dewey Morris." Now, Dewey Morris was the youngest. He was only 25 years old. And at the time, he was living in a boarding house in Bend, Oregon. He was a he was working at this logging camp and had a brother that worked with him there too, and his name was Owen Morris. Now, it's kind of a sketchy guy. Not a sketchy guy, but he has a interesting story, okay? Take it for what it is. Now, according to most people, he was a good guy. And in 1923, he went out on a date with a 27-year-old widow who lived in town. She later on said that after that date, he sexually assaulted her in his car. And his boss pretty much stood behind him, believed him, that he said, "I didn't do anything, I didn't assault her." You know, maybe they had sex, and then she said that, being true or not being true, I don't know. But what really happened here is that he had a lot of witnesses, and in the end, by April of 1923, he was found not guilty. But if you lived in a small town for any time during your life, you probably know what it is to live in a small town. You basically need to be perfect. You can't mess up, or that be your nickname, or that you will be known for that. So the gossip was crazy around him. Like, he was a pervert, like he was a rapist, and most people that knew this guy said that there's no way he did it. So his friend Roy was one of them, and he believed that he didn't do anything. So he thought, "I'm gonna take him away for the winter," in the hopes that things would calm down by the time we get back to town. So Roy Wilson's brother-in-law took Roy and Dewey to the cabin on October 1923. They were in the West Shore, half a mile away from the big lava lake. And just so you know, it was remote. However, if they could get to the ranger station, they had phones where they could communicate during the winter time. Most of the time, people that stayed there knew that they were going to get stuck there. Unless you wanted to snowshoe for miles to get out of that specific place. So the three guys met there. They took a picture and set the expectations and rules for what that winter was going to look like. Lots of work, but also lots of drinking and trying to make the best out of that winter. They agreed to go visit family on Christmas and try to sell some fur to make money while they were there. Edward Nichols was still scared, and while at the cabin, they often talk about how he was so scared that this guy, Lee Collins, was going to go after him and kill him. They would not stop talking about it. Edward more seriously. But Dewey and Roy tried to make fun of it and kind of light the mood. Now, they were spotted on Christmas in town. Edward and Roy, that is, not Dewey. He probably stayed behind to next thing we know about them. On January 15th, a friend stopped by the cabin for dinner. His name is, or was, Alan Wilcox. The same guy that kind of knew, well, that guy knew the three guys staying in the cabin. He also knew this guy, Lee Collins, that was running away from the police. I mean, there was no way that you'd stop by town and people didn't know a little bit about you. Now, this guy, Alan, he spent the night there, and he had a bit too much fun, and he decided to sleep it off and leave in the morning. Now, on January 22nd, 1924, in Portland, Oregon, which is north, you probably know where Portland is, but it was not the closest thing ever. For somebody that lived at that time. Now we just take I-5 and get pretty much anywhere in the state, but it's just one of those things that back then it was like, oh, you're going from Penn to Portland. And Oregon is not a huge state, but back then everything took a lot of time. So sell this when he can sell them in town. Well, March came around and the boys were not back. By mid-April, Roy's mother was worried sick. She knew her son wouldn't break a promise and it's been months. She was worried because she knew about this guy that was running away from the police, you know, Lee Collins, that in his real last name was Kimsey. Well, she knew about Kimsey, and she was afraid that Kimsey went after Edward Nichols, and she knew that the sole purpose of Roy being there was for protection, and by now she knew that something so she asked her son-in-law, Herbie. Herbie, please go check on them. Herbie tried to put her at ease and said, you know, there's a lot of snow on the ground still. They're probably okay and just waiting on the weather. But if they were able to get out for Christmas, she knew that they would be able to get out by February. So on April 13th, Herbie, which was Roy's brother-in-law, and Owen, remember, to his brother, both of them decided to go to the cabin. The snow was super high, and they were only able to take the vehicle about seven miles out still from the cabin. So they had to snowshoe all the way to the cabin. But they did. And when they got there, they found the cabin was a mess. Moldy food, dishes, garbage, and even a starving cat. The most disturbing discovery was the jackets, boots, and guns. They knew that the guys wouldn't leave those things inside the cabin. And house. They followed the tracks and found the sled that was somebody was trying to hide between some bushes and trees. They were reported missing, and the investigation started immediately. How can they vanish? How can they disappear? It didn't make sense. And if they were wandering out without a jacket, or if somebody took them so they could steal check out.